The Avro Lancaster, by far the most successful heavy bomber of the Second World War. Over 7,000 Lancasters were built, and from the aircraft's first bombing raid on March the 10th, 1942, to the end of the war, Lancasters flew more than 156,000 operational sorties and served with 56 RAF squadrons. The Lancaster was, without doubt, the most potent and destructive weapon in the arsenal of RAF Bomber Command. With its enormous unobstructive bomb bay, measuring 33 feet by 5 feet, and its ability to carry a load greater than its own weight, the Lancaster proved capable of delivering bombs of a size never even imagined by its designers. The most remarkable were the 12,000-pound tall boy and the 22,000-pound Grand Slam earthquake bombs, the heaviest conventional bomb ever devised. On March the 14th, 1945, the Grand Slam, along with several tall boys, was used for the first time against the Bielefeld viaduct. The raid by Lancasters of 617 Dam Buster Squadron was a stunning success. More than 100 yards of viaduct collapsed. Dramatic exploits such as the Bielefeld raid, although severe blows to Nazi Germany, were only a small part of the Lancaster's contribution to the Allied war effort. In 3 years of operations, in which over 4,000 Lancasters were lost, the aircraft dropped over 600,000 tons of bombs, two-thirds of Bomber Command's total tonnage, and over 50 million incendiaries. Amongst the tens of thousands of aircrew whose task it was to fly the Lancaster deep into enemy territory, the aircraft won the highest degree of respect and admiration. The Lancaster was a joy to handle and was utterly without vices, suffering fewer accidents than any other bomber in service. It was also extremely robust, able to absorb heavy battle damage and still get its crew home. The Lancaster's forgiving flight characteristics also meant that in an emergency, the aircraft could be flown by the navigator or flight engineer. There was no necessity for a second pilot, and so Bomber Command saved tens of thousands of hours of precious training time. Although the Lancaster was a night bomber for the first 2 years of its wartime career, it was nevertheless extremely heavily armed, a factor of the utmost importance for aircrew who might be faced at any time with a marauding German night fighter. Unlike German bombers, the Lancaster's machine guns, 8303 Brownings, were mounted in power-operated turrets, giving excellent target tracking. For almost the whole duration of the war, The Herculean task faced by Bomber Command was the destruction of Germany's military and industrial capability. In the attempt, 47,268 Bomber Command aircrew died in action. The degree to which the strategic bombing offensive contributed to the defeat of Germany is still a matter of heated debate. But what is certain is that without the Avro Lancaster, Bomber Command's campaign would have been, from the outset, doomed to failure. Britain's declaration of war on Germany, announced on September the 3rd, 1939, found RAF Bomber Command in a position it had never anticipated. None of the major war plans it had devised over the preceding years could be acted upon. All had anticipated a German offensive in the west, directed at France and the Low Countries. Instead, Hitler had struck at Poland. Bomber Command's Western Air Plan 4 had envisaged intensive bombing operations to cut the German army's supply lines in a battle for France. Striking at the German army in Poland, a distance of 700 miles from the nearest Bomber Command airfield, was beyond the RAF's capabilities. Hitler's orders forbidding the Luftwaffe to attack British cities neutralized Bomber Command's Western Air Plan 1, in which, in the event of Britain being bombed, the RAF was to strike at German airfields. Only one option remained, an offensive against German war industries, military depots, and oil fields. The strategic bombing campaign that had been at the heart of British defense strategy since the 1920s. Yet, even this option was closed almost at once. On the day that Poland had been invaded, the American president, Franklin D. Roosevelt, had appealed to all nations involved to refrain from bombing civilian targets and any installations where civilians might be at risk. Britain and France had agreed immediately. On September the 18th, Hitler made a similar undertaking. With characteristically cynical disregard for agreements of any kind, 1 week later, Hitler began the systematic terror bombing of the Polish capital, Warsaw. Even after Warsaw, the British government continued to insist that RAF Bomber Command must not attack German industrial targets. To Air Chief Marshal Ludlow Hewitt, Chief of Bomber Command, the delay was not wholly unwelcome. A brilliant and much respected commander, Ludlow Hewitt was well aware that the RAF's grandiose plans for a strategic bombing offensive had never been matched by adequate aircraft or navigational equipment. The RAF's most numerous bomber at the outbreak of war was the Fairy Battle. Well suited to colonial policing operations, the Battle, with its 1,000-pound bomb load, its top speed of 243 miles per hour, an armament of only two machine guns, was plainly inadequate for raids into Germany. Later, in the Battle of France, Fairy Battle squadrons would be virtually annihilated by the German fighters. The Bristol Blenheim, when it first entered service in 1937, was the fastest medium bomber in the world. A reconnaissance Blenheim was the first British aircraft in World War II to penetrate German airspace, photographing the port of Wilhelmshaven on September the 2nd. Armed with two machine guns and capable of carrying 1,300 pounds of bombs, the Blenheim would give excellent service in a variety of roles throughout the war. But as a day bomber, it was, in 1939, already close to obsolete. The Handley Page Hamden could carry a far heavier bomb load than the Blenheim, 4,000 pounds, over a range of 1,200 miles. It was, in theory, a fast aircraft, but its economical cruising speed was only 155 miles per hour, slow in a daylight bomber, and it was armed with only four Vickers machine guns, no match for German fighters. The Armstrong Whitworth Whitley was capable of carrying 5,500 pounds of bombs over a distance of 1,300 miles, and much had been expected of it. But it too was a disappointment. The Whitley was only 10 miles per hour faster than the Handley, and its operating ceiling of 17,600 feet was dangerously low. The Whitley would be withdrawn from frontline service in 1941. Of all of the RAF bombers in 1939, the Vickers Wellington was the only really successful design. It was fast and well armed. With six 303 machine guns in nose and tail turrets, and its ability to carry a 4,500 pound bomb load 1,500 miles, the Wellington was intended to put into practice the doctrine that closely grouped, heavily armed bombers could fight their way to any target. The doctrine would prove tragically false, but nevertheless, the rugged and reliable Wellington would emerge as the finest twin-engine bomber of the early war years. It was the RAF's Wellingtons and Blenheims which opened Bomber Command's campaign in the autumn of 1939. To avoid civilian casualties, the targets chosen were German warships in the approaches to their North Sea bases. The unescorted bombers were met by heavy flak and fighter defenses. The British bomber crews pressed home their attacks with great courage. But they'd never been adequately trained in anti-shipping operations, and their 500-pound bombs were totally inadequate for attacks on heavily armored warships. The enemy suffered little damage. In 861 bomber sorties, only 61 tons of bombs could be dropped, while 43 aircraft and over 100 aircrew were lost. On April the 9th, 1940, German forces invaded Denmark and Norway. Little could be done to help Denmark, but Bomber Command was ordered to do what it could to slow the German campaign in Norway. On April the 12th, in the biggest RAF bombing operation of the war so far, 83 aircraft, 36 Wellingtons, 24 Hamdens, and 23 Blenheims attacked German shipping at Stavanger. The RAF bombers had no fighter cover. The 1,000-mile round trip was well beyond the range of RAF Hurricanes and Spitfires. Intense flak and large numbers of fighters met the raid. For Bomber Command, the Stavanger operation was a turning point. Any illusion that well-armed bombers could defend themselves was brutally dispelled. Six Hamdens and three Wellingtons were lost. In the wake of the raid, both Wellingtons and Hamdens were withdrawn from daylight operations. It was the German bombing of Rotterdam on May the 14th, 1940, that prompted the lifting of Britain's self-imposed embargo on the bombing of German industrial targets. For the next 4 years, attacks on German cities would occupy almost all of Bomber Command's resources.
Operation night. GP1562.
The offensive would be carried out by night. Priority targets were synthetic oil plants, aircraft factories, and from March 1941, U-boat yards and bases. The most successful of the RAF bombers in the first phase of the strategic bombing offensive was, without doubt, the Vickers Wellington. By the time of its withdrawal in 1943, the Wellington would have dropped 32,000 tons of bombs on targets in Germany and the occupied countries. The switch to night bombing, although it dramatically reduced Bomber Command's casualties, had profound consequences for the effectiveness of the strategic campaign. Crews were barely trained in night operations, and the RAF had no radio navigation aids. In June and July 1941, a report concluded that only one-third of air crews succeeded in placing their bombs within 5 miles of the target. Over the heavily defended industrial area of the Ruhr, the figure was as low as one-tenth. In overcast conditions, the proportion of aircraft navigating to within 5 miles of their target fell to 1 in 15. Throughout 1941, losses steadily mounted. German night fighters, increasingly aided by radar, took a heavy toll. Between July and November, 414 night bombers and 112 day bombers were lost, the equivalent of Bomber Command's entire frontline strength in only 4 months. In a single raid on Berlin on November the 8th, of a force of 169 British bombers, 21 were lost, a shattering 12.4%. The costly failure of the night bombing offensive was a bitter blow to Bomber Command. But since, as yet, the only way in which Britain could strike at Germany on any scale was by bombing, the offensive would have to continue. Many believed that the failure was simply due to inadequate numbers, and there were calls for a force of 4,000 bombers to be built, a wildly unrealistic objective. Improved beam and radar navigation aids would soon lead to a dramatic improvement in the ability of crews to find their targets. But it was not only poor target finding that restricted the effectiveness of the campaign. What was required were bombers which could carry a much greater payload. The hopes of Bomber Command lay with a new generation of heavy bombers, now reaching the squadrons in significant numbers. The first of the heavies to enter service was the short Stirling, introduced in February 1941. The Stirling's bomb load, 14,000 pounds for a range of 740 miles, was adequate. But the aircraft's divided bomb bay prevented the carrying of bombs over 4,000 pounds. Even though it was armed with 8 machine guns, the Stirling's low speed of 245 miles per hour and low ceiling of 16,000 feet caused by its narrow wingspan, made it easy prey for enemy flak and fighters. Next came the Handley Page Halifax, which made its operational debut in March 1941. Its bomb-carrying capacity was less than the Stirling, but it was better armed and faster, with 9 guns, a top speed of 260 miles per hour, and a ceiling of 21,000 feet. The Halifax played a major role in the night offensive over Germany from 1942, dropping 250,000 tons of bombs. Introduced in late 1940, the Avro Manchester had been seen as one of the key elements in a revitalized bomber command. Instead, it was an unmitigated disaster, loathed by all who were condemned to fly in it. The Manchester was intended to replace the Handley Page Hampden, but the aircraft was not even capable of reaching the Hampden's 20,000-foot ceiling. The source of the trouble was the Manchester's two 1,800-horsepower Rolls-Royce Vulture engines. Not only were they underpowered, but they were fatally unreliable. The Manchester's undercarriage, too, was prone to failure. Of 10 squadrons equipped with Manchesters, 202 aircraft in all, 50 would be lost in takeoff or landing, a staggering 25% of operational aircraft. In action, the Manchester's low ceiling and the exposed positioning of vital coolant pipes underneath each engine made the aircraft extremely vulnerable to enemy flak. If one engine failed, the aircraft lost height with alarming speed. 80 Manchesters, 40% of the total, were lost to enemy action. Avro's chief designer, Roy Chadwick, had never believed in the Rolls-Royce Vulture and had accepted the engine with the greatest reluctance. He was, however, convinced that the Manchester's airframe was a sound design. In 1939, he had submitted to the Air Ministry a proposal for a four-engine version of the Manchester, and the idea was accepted. But Chadwick was warned that no Rolls-Royce Merlin engines would be available. All Merlin production, he was told, was reserved for the Hurricane and Spitfire. Chadwick nevertheless acquired four Merlins and set about adapting a Manchester for trials. The wings were extended to 102 feet and given a lighter metal covering. The fuselage center section was also modified, but otherwise it was virtually a standard Manchester airframe. The distinctive Manchester central fin was abandoned in favor of the same long-span twin-fin tailplane fitted to later Manchester 1As. The result was a startling success. The new aircraft was called the Manchester 3, later renamed the Lancaster. With the end of the Battle of Britain and the resulting increase in the availability of Merlin engines, a full-scale manufacturing program could begin. In October 1941, the first production Lancaster made its maiden flight. The Manchester's transformation into the Lancaster produced a change in performance so dramatic as to appear almost miraculous. The Lancaster's pleasing proportions betrayed nothing of its hastily improvised origins, and it was at once apparent to all who flew the new aircraft that Roy Chadwick and his team had designed a superb warplane. The Lancaster 1 had a range of 1,730 miles with a 12,000 pound bomb load. Its top speed, fully bombed up and fueled, was 275 miles per hour at 15,000 feet. And its service ceiling was 24,500 feet. As the war progressed, a later version, the Lancaster 3, would be introduced, differing remarkably little from the original version, but capable of delivering a 22,000-pound payload. At last, Bomber Command had at its disposal a weapon capable of fulfilling its long-cherished strategic aims. For the strategic bombing campaign, the introduction of the Lancaster was the beginning of a new chapter, a chapter marked by the appointment on February the 22nd, 1942, of Air Chief Marshal Sir Arthur Harris as the command's new head. Almost at once, Harris's extraordinary talent for leadership made itself felt throughout the command. From senior officers to the rank and file, there was a new spirit of confidence and determination. There were also new orders. 8 days before Arthur Harris had been appointed, the Air Ministry had issued a new directive. Bomber Command's task was to destroy the will of the German people by the area bombing of major cities. The area bombing campaign would last almost without pause for the next 2 years. It would be waged almost entirely by night and at great cost. In the vanguard of the offensive would be increasing numbers of Bomber Command's Lancasters. The first operation over Germany in which the Lancaster took part was a raid on Essen on the night of March the 10th, 1942. Throughout the months of March, April and May, the numbers of Lancasters deployed in raids on German cities rose steadily until on May the 30th, 73 Lancasters were available to take part in the area bombing of Cologne, the first 1,000-bomber raid. Operation Millennium, in which 1,445 tons of bombs were dropped on Cologne, destroyed almost 3,500 houses and 36 factories. The docks and railway system were badly hit, and electricity, water, and gas supplies wrecked. 12,000 fires were started in the city. The two further 1,000-bomber raids which followed Operation Millennium were far less successful than the first. A raid on Essen was disrupted by poor weather, and in an attack on Bremen, in which 96 Lancasters took part, 48 bombers were lost and 65 damaged. Bomber Command's mounting casualties were due above all to the increasing efficiency of German night fighter defenses. At the beginning of 1941, Germany had possessed only 164 night fighters and a primitive system of early warning. Nevertheless, by the end of the year, night fighters had shot down 422 British aircraft. It was the appointment in August of a superb tactician, General Josef Kammhuber, as chief of German night defenses that tipped the balance in the Luftwaffe's favor. As well as night fighters, Kammhuber's command included two searchlight divisions, three signal regiments, and some day fighter units. In 1942, Kammhuber increased his night fighter strength to 350, and he completely reorganized the night defense control system. The airspace over Germany and the occupied countries was divided into box-shaped sectors. Each box relied on three radar stations. The long-range Freya, which could detect a bomber force at 100 miles, and two narrow-beam Würzburg radars, which could pick up a single aircraft at 30 miles. When the Freya long-range radar detected an impending raid, the night fighters were scrambled, each fighter taking up position in one of the boxes through which the raid would have to pass. The night fighter pilots were hand-picked experts, and many were capable of downing six or more bombers, even heavily armed Lancasters, in a single night. 1942, most German night fighters were Messerschmitt 110 or Junkers 88C twin-engined aircraft. Both were relatively slow, but either could easily overhaul a Lancaster heavy with bombs. As one of each pair of Würzburg radars tracked the British bombers as they entered a box, the other would track the night fighter, vectoring it into position for an attack. Few bomber crews ever saw a night fighter before it struck. Even fewer survived an attack. Bomber Command's operational research section estimated that while most aircraft which returned to Britain damaged had been hit by flak, most aircraft lost had been claimed by night fighters. There was a significant weakness in the cam Huber line, and it was soon found and exploited by Bomber Command. If large numbers of bombers entered German airspace in a narrow stream, they could minimize the number of boxes through which they would have to pass, and so the number of night fighters in their way. Even so, German night fighter defenses would continue to inflict agonizing losses until July 1943, when British bombers began to drop foil strips known as window to confuse the German radar. Even this ingenious countermeasure would win Bomber Command only a temporary respite. Throughout 1942, Bomber Command's losses mounted steadily. By the end of the year, they had reached 4.3%. A man selected as aircrew was expected to fly 50 operations in two tours of duty. With a loss rate of even 4%, only 13 men out of 100 would survive those 50 missions. Even though all air crew were volunteers, the flow of men requesting to join bomber crews never faltered. Of all the services, the Royal Air Force was, in the eyes of the British public, an elite band of men. And of the RAF, the crews of Bomber Command Lancasters were seen as an elite amongst an elite. So demanding was this, the most technologically advanced form of warfare, that the training undergone by Lancaster aircrew was extraordinarily lengthy and arduous. After medical tests and a comprehensive assessment, which ended in the rejection of most applicants, the few accepted were sent to the aircrew reception center at Regent's Park in London. There they were kitted out, inoculated, and after 10 days, dispatched for a 12-week stint at an initial training wing, where the emphasis was on drill and basic ground training. Each man was provisionally allocated a specialized role as pilot, navigator, bomb aimer, flight engineer, or wireless operator air gunner. For pilots, navigators, and bomb aimers, there was further training in the United States or Canada. For these highly skilled tasks, training could take a further 18 months. Next, each man, now a specialist, was sent to an operational training unit. The task of the OTU was to weld a disparate collection of individuals into tightly knit seven-man teams, the future crews of Lancaster bombers. Operational training unit courses lasted 4 to 5 months, and even before crews had flown over enemy territory, the risks were high. Some courses lost over a quarter of their number in accidents, and in all, 5,327 men were killed in training, one-tenth of the number of Bomber Command casualties due to enemy action. Of those who successfully completed operational training, Not all would be assigned to the much-coveted Lancaster squadrons. Those that were regarded themselves as the fortunate ones. All knew that the Lancaster offered both the greatest chance of survival and the capacity to hit the enemy harder than any other aircraft. By early 1943, the impact of the Lancaster was so great that a single Lancaster group could drop a greater tonnage of bombs in one night than the whole of Bomber Command only a year before. And the bomb loads themselves were becoming ever more powerful and flexible. A conventional load of 250 and 500 pounders could be carried, or a 4,000 pound cylindrical cookie blast bomb could be added to a load of general purpose bombs or incendiaries. Alternatively, the cookie could be doubled to form an 8,000 pounder and dropped along with six 500 pound general purpose bombs, a devastating combination. Perhaps the most extraordinary payload ever carried by a Lancaster was the bouncing bomb, used in the famous attack by 617 Squadron against the Ruhr Dams. Devised by Barnes Wallace, who also invented the Grand Slam 22,000 pounder, the bouncing bombs had to be delivered by specially modified Lancasters flying at an altitude of precisely 60 feet. Arrayed by 19 Lancasters on the night of May the 16th, 1943, was a brilliant success. Two dams were breached, releasing over 200 million tons of water. Supplies to key Ruhr industries were cut, and transport and power supplies widely disrupted. Guy Gibson, the 25-year-old wing commander who led the raid, was awarded the Victoria Cross. Tragically, Guy Gibson was killed on a much less hazardous operation only a year later. The period from March to July 1943 saw the second great offensive in Bomber Command's strategic war against Germany. With more Lancasters, more destructive bombs, and with greatly improved radio and radar navigational aids, Bomber Command launched the series of massive raids known as the Battle of the Ruhr. Germany's industrial heartland, the most heavily defended area in the world, was blasted with 60,000 tons of bombs in 4.5 months. The cost was horrendous, 872 bombers lost. But the result was a blow to Germany more wounding than any it had yet received at the hands of British bombers. After the Ruhr, it was the turn of Hamburg to suffer a full-scale bomber onslaught. The city had already been attacked 98 times, but now, beginning on the night of July the 24th, it was hit by four heavy raids in the space of 10 nights. On each occasion, more than 770 bombers took part, including up to 350 Lancasters. Foil window was used for the first time to jam the German radar, and Bomber Command's losses were minimal. The cost to Hamburg of this collapse of the night defense system was horrendous. A raging firestorm utterly devastated an enormous area of the city, killing many thousands of civilians. The ordeal of Hamburg was not confined to the hours of darkness. B-17s of the United States Army Air Force bombed the city by day, targeting factories, U-boat yards, and power stations. As yet, the Allies had no fighter with the range to penetrate far into Germany. And the American B-17s, in spite of their heavy defensive armament, suffered appalling losses. As their British allies had learned in 1941, unescorted daylight bombing was quite simply suicidal. Armed After the Battle of Hamburg, Bomber Command's main efforts were directed at Italy. Between the 3rd and 15th of August 1943, the cities of Genoa, Milan and Turin were attacked by up to 500 aircraft, including as many as 320 Lancasters. The raids were highly successful and did much to force Italy's surrender to the Allies 3 weeks later. On November the 3rd, 1943, Air Chief Marshal Sir Arthur Harris told the British Prime Minister Winston Churchill, "We can wreck Berlin from end to end. It will cost us between 400 and 500 aircraft. It will cost Germany the war." The Battle of Berlin began on November the 18th and lasted almost 4.5 months. Up to 890 aircraft at a time attacked the city in 16 major raids, in all 9,111 sorties. On some nights, over 500 Lancasters took part. In spite of the massive air power directed against it, Berlin would not suffer the fate of Hamburg. The capital was almost 30 times the area of Hamburg, and the offensive was spread over a much longer period of time. At no point were the city's firefighting efforts or its essential services completely overwhelmed, nor were its night fighter defenses found wanting. Since the use of window had so baffled the German night fighters during the Battle of Hamburg, the Luftwaffe had developed far more flexible tactics. Instead of being rigidly directed, radar-equipped night fighters known as Wild Boar freelanced in the path of the British bomber stream. Others, designated Tame Boar, were directed to their targets by every available means, including the broadcast of a running commentary describing every change of course made by the raiders. Countermeasures adopted by Bomber Command included the jamming of German commentaries and even the broadcast of fake commentaries to mislead the night fighters. However, the impact of such countermeasures was limited, and British losses rose to a horrifying level. In the course of the battle, 517 aircraft, including 394 Lancasters, were lost. To Bomber Command, it was a devastating blow. In spite of the sacrifice of thousands of British airmen, Berlin was not wrecked from end to end. Damage, although severe, came nowhere near causing the collapse that Harris had foretold. As the Luftwaffe had failed to destroy British morale in the Blitz 3 years earlier, so Bomber Command had failed in its turn. Yet, in the wake of the Berlin tragedy, the Lancasters of Bomber Command would find a new role, this time one that would, without question, change the course of the war. The Allied landings on the coast of Normandy on June the 6th, 1944, were followed by 10 weeks of furious battles with a determined German defense. As the Allied army struggled to extend their precarious toehold on the European mainland, Bomber Command unleashed an aerial assault on an unprecedented scale. Each week saw Bomber Command fly an average of 5,000 sorties, a number equal to the total flown in the first 9 months of the war. It was a time of unparalleled intensity, with many crews flying 2 sorties a day. Their targets were German troop concentrations, arms dumps, road and rail links. Because raids on targets in France could be escorted by long-range fighters, precision daylight attacks by Lancasters were at last a viable option for Bomber Command. The first daylight raid by Lancasters in the Normandy campaign was on June the 14th, when 221 aircraft, some armed with 12,000-pound tallboy bombs, attacked a major German E-boat base at Le Havre, a mortal threat to ships supplying the Allied beachheads. The raid was a resounding success, ravaging the harbor area. Only a single Lancaster was lost. On July the 18th, 942 aircraft, including 667 Lancasters, attacked five fortified villages east of Caen, which stood in the path of Operation Goodwood, a major British armored offensive. Over 5,000 tons of bombs were dropped, crippling two German divisions. The Caen raids would rank as Bomber Command's most effective tactical operation of the entire war. Between June 14th and July the 24th, Bomber Command's Lancasters flew 72 missions, most in support of ground forces and many involving several hundred aircraft. On July the 25th, Lancasters of 5 Group attacked an airfield and main signals depot for the German Air Force in France at Saint-Cyr. The area had been attacked before, and some Luftwaffe operations transferred to a nearby military college. The college was completely destroyed, and Luftwaffe communications wrecked for the loss of only one Lancaster. On July the 30th, 492 Lancasters, 200 Halifaxes, and 30 Mosquitoes bombed 6 German positions facing an American attack in the Villiers-Bocage-Comont area, opening the way for a successful advance. The following day, 127 Lancasters attacked a major railway marshalling yard at Jeanville-la-Roche. Bombing was extremely accurate, and track, maintenance facilities, and rolling stock were devastated. Between June the 16th and August the 2nd, Lancasters carried out 34 raids on flying bomb and V-weapon sites, severely curtailing German operations against London. On August the 3rd, Bomber Command's efforts were switched to flying bomb depots, and over 1,100 aircraft, including over 600 Lancasters, attacked 3 major stores. The weather was clear and bombing very accurate. On August the 5th, 742 aircraft, including over 250 Lancasters, attacked storage sites at Forêt-de-Nieppe and Saint-Lô-d'Azur. Again, conditions were excellent, and damage to the sites extremely heavy. As the Allied armies broke out of Normandy and raced across France, the Lancasters' role in the Allied campaign changed once more. Missions in support of ground operations continued, but the real emphasis was once again the bombing of strategic targets. The German synthetic oil industry was a priority, but Arthur Harris also resumed his offensive against major German cities in the hope that a last great effort would cause the final collapse that Bomber Command had sacrificed so much to achieve. The city of Dresden was attacked on the night of February the 13th, 1945, by 769 Lancasters in 2 raids, dropping 1,478 tons of high explosives and 1,182 tons of incendiaries. The result was a firestorm as devastating as that which had swept Hamburg in July 1944. Tens of thousands of civilians, including many thousands of refugees, died in the inferno. On March the 2nd, the last RAF raid on Cologne was carried out by 858 aircraft, including 531 Lancasters and 303 Halifaxes. 3,000 tons of bombs were dropped. The raid was immensely destructive, opening the way for a successful American assault on the city. Only six Lancasters were lost, one still laden with bombs taking a direct hit, exploding at an altitude of 20,000 feet. Less than 9 weeks after the bombing of Cologne, Germany, devastated and overrun, at last surrendered to the Allies. The contribution of strategic bombing to the final victory remains a controversial question. But at least some aspects of the campaign did have profound consequences. The destruction of the industrial Ruhr forced the dispersal of many war industries throughout the length and breadth of Germany. The resulting dependence of German production on a rail transportation network, soon destroyed piecemeal by the Allies, was in the end decisive. The Lancaster offensive against the synthetic oil plants, ironically a campaign in which Arthur Harris had had little faith, would later emerge as a key factor in the destruction of Hitler's Luftwaffe. In the closing weeks of the war, 4,000 brand new German aircraft, including many jet fighters, a force that could have cost the Allies enormous losses, were grounded for want of fuel. The Lancaster's career as the RAF's most powerful heavy bomber did not end with the defeat of Germany. Its designer, Roy Chadwick, was certain that the aircraft was capable of yet further development, and the war with Japan might demand a new generation of heavy bombers. The result was the Lancaster 4, later renamed the Lincoln. The prototype Lincoln, first flown in June 1944, had a greater speed, altitude and range than the Lancaster 3, but retained the ability to deliver a 22,000-pound bomb load. The imminent end of the war in Europe meant that the introduction of the Lincoln was repeatedly delayed. And by the time it entered service in 1945 with the RAF's Far East Tiger Force, the war with Japan was over. As for the original Lancaster, by the end of the 1940s, only a handful remained in RAF service, most as reconnaissance aircraft. Until in October 1956, the last Lancaster in RAF service was decommissioned. The Avro Lincoln served on until the end of the decade, some as in-flight refueling tankers, but many seeing action in their original role of heavy bomber against insurgents in Malaya and Kenya. The Lincoln was the last piston engine bomber in RAF service. Only one airworthy Lancaster remains, the City of Lincoln, preserved by the RAF's Battle of Britain Memorial Flight. Its dedicated maintenance staff and its flight crew are all highly skilled volunteers. Their aim is to keep the RAF's last Lancaster flying well into the next century, a tribute to the courage and sacrifice of the men of Bomber Command, and to a remarkable aircraft.